This is a talk on melanoma, and I'm also going to talk about melanoma immunotherapy, which is a little bit of a clinical thing, but there are a lot of pathological aspects to it. Okay, let's see. And what I'm going to do today, I would like to give a couple of ideas about milestones in melanoma research in the last decade or so, and what is new related to Spitz tumors, and also I'm going to do something on melanoma immunotherapy. So with that, everyone has to fasten your seatbelt, because it will be a talk that will need a lot of attention. So regarding the staging information, this has recently been changed, and really the update here is that in case of the primary tumor, the T1 lesions are segregated into A and B categories depending whether they have ulceration or mitosis. And these primary tumor stage information is included in our reports. The current WHO classification characterizes or talks about superficial spreading type melanoma, nodular melanoma, acral and lentigo maligna type melanoma. And compare that, there is a review article by Dr. Boris Bastian, which I do recommend to read. All of you, it's like almost like a book chapter, which actually approaching melanocytic lesions or melanomas in a different way. It basically talks about lesions that has high sun-induced mechanisms, which in basically some of these lesions are having a high UV-associated factor, like desmoplastic melanoma or the lentigo maligna type of lesions. But there are low UV-associated lesions which are acquired nevi, and the lesions that are growing out of acquired nevi. And to this group also the spitzoid lesions belong to. Then glabrous skin harbors acral melanoma, mucosal skin harbors mucosal melanoma. And he also put here non-epithelium associated tissues like the eye, and from the eye, uveal nevi and uveal melanoma could arise. But there are rare cases when melanoma actually arising in internal organs. And we also have blue nevi in the skin and congenital nevi, and from those lesions, melanomas could arise as well. And how they arise in non-cumulative sun-induced melanomas, we have a nevus, and then there will be genetic alterations will lead to melanoma in situ and an invasive lesion. In case of acral type mucosal melanomas, the epithelium is first that is going to be involved, and then there will be vertical invasion to the skin. And in desmoplastic melanoma, we think that it is not epithelium associated, although we have a population of atypical cells that simulate or actually fulfill the criteria of melanoma in situ in the epidermis. And in case of melanoma in blue nevi or congenital nevi, they are usually arising from dermal nest, what the literature says, but sometimes it is controversial, that larger congenital nevi, like a garment type of nevi, will give rise to these dermal-based tumors, whereas smaller type lesions will be more like this non-CSD melanoma group. And if you go through the categories, and I don't really want to go through, but you can see that in the non-cumulative sun-induced type lesions occurring in the third to sixth decade, in case of the cumulative sun-induced lesions like lentigo maligna type of tumors, the seventh decade, and patients who are even older than that, acral nevi, mucosal nevi, uveal, desmoplastic spitzoid lesions so on and so forth. So it is a very good summary, and I, because the lecture is kind of long, I don't really have right now time to go over all these categories. But it is an interesting view and interesting how it evolved during time. And one of the reasons that this evolved, and these are just a couple of images for a melanoma, halo nevus, intradermal nevus, and then mucosal melanomas, acral type of melanomas. It is very important that these lesions are actually associated with different kind of mutations. And this table describes the primary oncogenic events in melanocytic neoplasia, and the frequent culprits here, the NRAS mutation, which is a point mutation, HRAS, BRAF mutation, which we all know about, which could also be an acquired device, so it is not only melanoma that could have BRAF mutation, but as in Spitz nevi and acral nevi as well. And we have the KIT mutation, the GNAC and the GNA11 mutations, which are important in the sense that they are very frequent in uveal melanomas in both of these mutations. So you can actually make a distinction if this mutation is present, that it is most likely that lesion is going to arise from the eyes. And I'm going to talk about these kinase functions a little bit later. There are also secondary oncogenic events in melanocytic neoplasia, and a couple of things, for example, the TERT, it's a promoter mutation, and that will lead to telomere elongation. That's really the function. If it is damaged, then it is going to kind of lead to elongation of the telomere, and that will give longevity to the tumors. And then other things like the MITF mutation is an amplification, and then we have other mutations which are loss of function alterations. And here I would like to focus on the CDKN2A mutation, which is a deletion, and it is associated with the RB pathway via the P16 and the P53 pathways. And I will get back to this, because we can use a very simple immunohistochemical method, and that could help us to pick sometimes lesions that are more sinister. And another thing that I would like to highlight here, because this is a very long table to go through, so I'm just kind of jumping on one or two of these genes, the BUP1 gene, which is a very important one, because the deletion of this or mutation of this gene could lead to uveal melanomas, but also it could lead to renal cell cancer or mesothelioma. So it's a very, very important thing in melanoma pathogenesis. And I'm coming back to this table for a reason, because there are several now well-characterized kinase functions like the ALK, the ROS1, the RET, and the NTRK1 kinase functions, which are characteristic for Spitz tumor. And we don't really know if what is their real function. Probably this is an early event in the pathogenesis of Spitz nevi. And with that, you know, I decided to add a couple, actually three cases only. And these three cases will kind of will be like case vignettes and describing issues related to these genes that I showcased to you. So the first one is a 27-year-old female with several large nevi. And this picture is from where? Is anyone knows that, you know, if you see this picture, what is matrix? Very good. So it is coming from the matrix. So, and it is coming from the matrix because if we are looking at histology, sometimes these histological images also give us clues that what kind of genetic alterations we could face. So the histological patterns can tell us about genetic alterations. And this case is actually an example of that. So this is the lesion. As you can see, it's a fairly large pedunculated lesion on the low power. It is not too concerning. Someone could say, okay, it's just an intradermal nevus. Maybe it is a compound nevus. And then when we are examining different parts of it, then there is a variation in pattern. So there are areas that are larger. I mean, I would not say larger, but are fainter in staining, like here, here, here. And then there are these small type B melanocytes close to those areas. And this is a medium power of some of these larger nests. As you can see, it is the staining intensity is less, and then we have the type B melanocytes next to it. Again, the same thing, type B melanocytes, and then we have the somewhat irregular cells which show some cytological atypia. And when you see these lesions, this could be actually pretty daunting. And when I was looking at one of these lesions, I was thinking that maybe the patient has, you know, schizoid melanoma or something like that. It had a schizoid quality to this. You see these cells, there are no real mitotic figures. So if you stain it up with a proliferation marker like Ki67, you don't really see anything like increased activity. However, there are multiple prominent nucleoli, and the cytological atypia is also prominent. And if we stain this up with the antibody, the BEP1 antibody, then you can see that those areas that shows this epithelial morphology are actually not staining with these antibody. However, those type B melanocytes are going to be. So what is the significance of this? The first thing was that when Dr. Wiesner described this, and this is really kind of a, also I have to tell that this is a group effort, so there are some giants of the fields here, like Heinz Kutzner, Dr. Bastian, Dr. Ceroni, among others. They found that in families, they were able to find, you know, these are clinically very innocent looking lesions. On the histology, they have this epithelioid morphology, and they were able to find that they are actually mutated. They don't express the BOP1, or the BOP1 gene is mutated in these lesions. So the BOP1 is basically the BRCA-associated protein 1 gene, and it acts as a tumor suppressor. So it means that if it is missing, then tumors could arise. And the mutation could be germline or somatic mutation, and it is associated, as I already told you, in uveal melanoma, in epithelioid spitz tumors, mesothelioma, basal cell carcinoma, clear cell renal cell carcinoma. So it is important to do genetic counseling, oncological studies. So if it is like a germline mutation, then it is possible that there could be patients who are presenting, and you as dermatologist, it is a very, very good clue. I think that someone would feel really well if looking at a patient like this, and you can see that, well, you know, he has this pedunculated nevi, and they all look normal. However, if you biopsy this, you have this histology, and then if you have the BOP1 mutation, then maybe you can alert the patient that he or she might evolve uveal melanoma, renal cell carcinoma, and early detection of those tumors could save the patient's life. So I think it is a really important thing to know about it. You can ask that what is the significance if we find this as an isolated lesion. In those cases, I don't think that it has too much relevance. If the patient don't have probably more than 3 lesions of these, but the literature out there is still kind of very early to tell that how many exactly the lesions that would dip the scale to one or the other direction, then you have to do some genetic counseling. So, but if someone is coming 3, 4, 5 of these large nevi, and we find above one mutated in those lesions, then the patient needs an oncological counseling. And actually, we had a case like that, and you can see these lesions here. It was actually a melanoma excision, and I got this case, and it was serial resection, and we went through the whole thing. And one of the later sections, obviously there is no melanoma here, we bump into a lesion that was above one negative process, which looked extremely odd-looking under the microscope. So the explanation there was that it had the BOP1 mutation. Anyway, so with that, if you see a nevus and you look down the microscope, then this pattern, this bimodal pattern of epithelioid cells and the smaller cells could reflect that there is a genetic alteration associated with BOP1 mutation. And I would like to add something else, also a great article, you know, from Dr. Wiesner's, that other patterns, like if the nevus has the schizoid lesion, has the spindle cell or school of fish pattern, then it is likely that it has ARK1 mutation. And if it has this kind of more sclerotic and epithelioid morphology, then it could have the NTRK1 mutation. Okay, so what is the reason for, or what are these kinase function fusions lead to? We think that, or as far as we understand, these are present in benign, atypical, and in malignant schizoid lesions. And probably this is an early event in melanoma genesis or in the formation of these melanocytic nevi, and it is necessary but insufficient for malignant transformation. But these kinase functions could be used potentially as therapeutic targets. Okay, so let's switch gears, and it is a four-year-old boy with a neck nodule, and if Leo is in the among the audience, then Leo will know about this case. If not, then you also guys may know about it. So this is a four-year-old boy who had this lesion that they were thinking that it's a molluscum on the neck, and he is very unhappy that they want to sample it. So they cut it. It is non-pigmented. It is a pedunculated nodule. It's a little bit, it was excoriated on the surface, but nothing too severe. And this is how the histology looked like. It was a little bit excoriated, but not a serrated lesion. The melanocytes, if you are looking at it, has some, I would say, about moderate cytological atypia. There were a couple of cells that has this hyperchromatic nuclei. Some of them had prominent nucleoli, but at the same time, you can see that there is epithelial hyperplasia. There is edema with almost incipient clefting around this nest. And you can also observe a couple of the comino bodies. And if we looked at it, is still, this is the epidermis, so this is not really a deep area. Atypical form and another atypical form. And I had, you know, the clinical, so I was a little bit biased. I had some issues to call this anything really like melanoma, so really malignant, although there were a couple of mitotic figures present. Here is one, there is another one, but these are all superficially located. I did a Ki-67 staining, which basically sometimes in rapidly growing Schwitz nevi, you see this pattern, but you can see it also in melanoma, that most of the proliferative activity is accentuated towards the superficial portion of the lesion. And it seems that the lesion is actually maturing as we are going towards the base. Now, my problem was that I couldn't pass on And I already talked to you about this, you know, the CDKNA2 gene mutations on 9th chromosome is the P16. So we have an antibody for P16, and usually if we are staining up a nevus for P16, then we have a checkerboard pattern. There are some cells which are expressing, some of the cells are not expressing P16, so a checkerboard pattern would have been expected. And in this case, the P16 is totally lost, and this kind of pattern is also seen in melanoma. So I decided to send the case to comparative genomic hybridization, and actually the comparative genomic hybridization showed chromosomal deletions. As you can see, the gains would be in here, the losses down here, so there are huge areas of the 9th chromosome that are missing, and that's why P16 is also negative. This is the proximal arm of 12q, 14q is also missing, and 18p is missing. So there are multiple chromosomal abnormalities, and this is just kind of the pathway to show to you. And this is the report that we received after the comparative hybridization and putting together all this information with the histology. The final diagnosis of melanoma of 1.3 millimeter in thickness was made, and it was extending to the deep portion of the biopsy. Now, I don't want to I don't want to debate whether this call is right or wrong. However, if you are looking at this lesion and if you are kind of thinking that clinically it looks extremely, you know, banal looking, then you are really kind of frightened. And if this little 4-year-old or 5-year-old happens to be your child, then he just got an incurable diagnosis. I mean, with this, if it is, you know, really 1.3 millimeter melanoma, he has a great chance of dying very soon. So with that, being a parent, this is a very, very difficult diagnosis to receive. And I was like, not because that okay, I didn't want to call it melanoma, but it was a difficult thing to accept that child has melanoma. Because, you know, when you are taking this child to an oncologist, then he will get treated as a melanoma patient. Although, you know, a lot of people say that, you know, childhood melanomas are behaving differently. And that's where I'm trying to take the this lecture. And because in my mind, there is the clinical appearance and the diagnosis, even though we have the CGH result, actually conclude in a system failure. Because at the end of the day, no one knows what is actually happening. So where are we with this? There are nevi that you need to know about, and these are so-called atypical Spitz tumors with uncertain biologic potential. And it is a fantastic article, you know, which was published in 2009 in Cancer by Dr. Ludgate and his colleagues. And the conclusion in this report is that these lesions do not appear to behave like conventional melanoma, and there is a high incidence of microscopic lymph node deposits in sentinel lymph node biopsies. And despite these findings, the patients have a favorable prognosis. And our findings raise several questions regarding the malignant potential of these lesions and the role of sentinel lymph node biopsies in their management. And there are additional articles on this one, a more recent one in 2011 in American Journal of Surgical Pathology. And it is kind of a very, very interesting paper, because all the diagnoses here, atypical spitzoid tumors, and then here there is spitzoid melanoma. The age is here, and then you can see what is interesting, the breast thickness of these lesions are pretty big, like 3 millimeter, 4 millimeter, 6.5 millimeter, 4.1 millimeter. Then the other interesting dermatomyositis, there are a lot. Sentinel lymph nodes are also positive in all of the almost all of the patients. And then the tumor burden in the sentinel lymph node biopsies are really sometimes really significant, because in this one, for example, number 5, 20% of the lymph node parenchyma is taken over. In case of the spitzoid melanoma patient, 50%, so half of the lymph node was taken over by tumor. And another lymph node, because there were 3 positive lymph nodes, so one was 50%, the second one 25%, and the third one was 1%. So it is amazing tumor burden. And then if you are looking at what is happening with these patients, that they are alive and no evidence of disease, which is extremely important. So what is happening on the genetic level? Are these patients are doing well because they don't have any chromosomal abnormalities? But actually, this is not the case, because as you can see, a lot of these patients, like patient number 1, has problems, losses and gains of chromosome 1, chromosome 4, chromosome 5, chromosome 9, chromosome 20. And the spitzoid melanoma patient, like our patient, had also losses on both arms of chromosome 9. And what is also interesting we are doing, you know, fish studies to find these melanomas. Is it melanoma or not? All the fish results were negative. So with all that, our finding in our case were that the patient got a wide local excision and the sentinel lymph node biopsy, and the sentinel lymph node was actually positive. However, the patient doesn't have evidence of systemic disease. So in conclusion, these atypical spitzoid lesions, especially if it is arising in young children, you know, they probably, most of them are behaving in a more indolent fashion. And it is really a big question to put out there how we should formulate those reports, whether we should really call it out, you know, melanoma, or we should back off a little bit and call them like uncertain malignant potential. And it seems, according to the seminal studies of Sophie Spitz, whose picture is here, that the prepubertal patients will do well and have a good prognosis. And the significance of diagnosing melanoma in a child is really kind of a very difficult task to do. Now, this was case number 2, and then we are switching again gears. Are you guys still, you know, up, and or is it too much information? Or okay, good, good. So there is here is Ivan Reitman on the left side, and this is on the scene of the Ghostbusters, and when Jason Reitman, Ivan Reitman's son, was considering to, you know, what to do with life, you know, maybe, you know, one of the best thing to do is actually to going and do medicine. And then Ivan Reitman said, you know, son, there is not enough magic in medicine. So this is the theme of our third case, and I'm trying to prove Mr. Reitman wrong on this, and we will see if you guys agree with me or not, although I absolutely like his work. So the third case is also my case. It's a 51-year-old male with an abdominal lesion. And what is the diagnosis? Anyone can give me. Very good. Very good. Okay, it is more like I'm checking who is sleeping, who is not sleeping, you know. So, well, we are talking about melanoma, and what is this lesion here? So, Okay, so it is probably this one is the primary tumor, okay, and then this could be a metastasis. And as you can see, this patient has been on the sun or under the sun. There are multiple flecks all over. And he had this for some time, but he didn't, okay. He didn't care about much about this. So, and I don't even show a histology on this. This was the large lesion, and these are the smaller lesions. You can see very nice. There is no epidermal connection. It's just consistent with the metastatic lesion. Here, there was epidermal connection. Actually, it was ulcerated, and it was at least 40 millimeter in thickness, but it was transected at the base. So the patient had this stage, basically metastatic disease already. And the question was that what's going on? What can we do with this patient? So I called up Dr. Mini on this, and I said that, I mean, this is really bad. And then he told me that, well, yeah, I agree, it is really bad because the patient doesn't have insurance. So what can we do? In this kind of situations, the good thing is to have a good zip code or living in the United States, because if you are living there, then there are protocols run at the National Institute of Health, which are doing research protocols for immunotherapy. And I suggested that this patient should go on immunotherapy. And they didn't have insurance. It's not an issue with immunotherapy because the NIH recruits these patients and treat them for free charge. So it's a fantastic thing. So what are the options for this patient? Well, one of them is chemotherapy and the other one is immunotherapy. I'm going to talk about the later. And if we go back in case of immunotherapy, then there are lots of things. So a lot of brain power went into things like tumor vaccines. A lot of brain power went into the dendritic cell-based immunotherapies, the combination of these therapies. And then these actually failed. One promising thing was interleukin 2, which was FDA approved in 1998. And then we have therapies like anti-CTLA-4 PD-1, which is a very recent one, and adoptive immunotherapy. And this is a review article by Dr. Rosenberg, who is one of the giant of the immunotherapy field. And he said that cancer immunotherapy has been successfully applied to the treatment of selected human cancers. However, dramatic progress in the following decade has moved immunotherapy from sidelines of cancer treatment into the mainstream of modern oncology. So just a question for you, if let's say you see this patient and this patient maybe have insurance and would be treated with regular therapies, what would be his 5-year survival potential? How many percent? Everyone is sleeping or just don't want to answer me. So you have this metastatic patient, 10%, thanks, 5%. Okay. Yeah. So it is around 5% for metastatic lesion, 20% is way too high. So let's just go, and I'm going to talk about these three things: adoptive immunotherapy, anti-CTLA-4, and anti-PD-1, anti-PD-L1 therapies. So, and to understand that, it is very important to know what is immunotherapy, because this looks extremely esoteric. So immunotherapy is actually happening on us, on everyday patients. This is a halo nevus. And in case of a halo nevus, this is not a halo nevus, but this is a halo nevus. Here, you have a lot of inflammatory infiltrate, but immunoreaction could actually also happen against melanomas. Now, this is one that is one of the most beautiful cases I ever had. and you can see diffuse pachytoid scatter. And then if you are going to the higher power, then there are individual cells that are chewed up by these lymphocytes. You can see that the lymphocytes are surrounding these, and we think that probably they are dying, but because we always just looking at, you know, one time point, we don't really see as a time lapse how these cells are dying. But in the inset, I'm showing that these cells are there. And I'm also going to show you, you know, that, okay, these cells are going to attack these tumor cells with their MHC1 receptors, and it shows that this area is the tumor. There are CD8 positive T cells which are attacking the tumor cells, and this is granzyme B reaction, which is a cytotoxic granules. And as you can see, that a couple of these CD8 positive cells are turning against these melanoma cells. So the response here, as you can see, is specific. Now, one thing that I would like to draw your attention that which was very disappointing to me, that if I see this amount of heavy lymphoid infiltrate to have only this amount of CD8 positive cells is kind of disappointing. And maybe that's the reason, or probably this is the reason why we are not self-curing our cells from melanoma. There is only a very, very small percentage of patients and anecdotal histories of, you know, like melanomas that kind of self-cured by the patient. Okay, so let's talk about first ipilimumab or Yervoy or anti-CTLA-4. What is this? Anti-CTLA-4is basically is a co-stimulator of the immune response. If it is blocked by the B7 receptor, then there won't be co-stimulation, there will be no T cell activation. If you are blocking it with Yervoy or ipilimumab, then this blockage will block the CTLA-4 molecule, and there could be activation of T cells. So how is it working, or what is the response? This report says that, patients have like 13, 25, 23% survival rate, 5-year survival rate, compared, you know, to the 5% that we already talked about. However, in patients who had complete responses, this will be a durable effect. So patients who had 15 patients who responded to, they have ongoing response beyond, you know, 54 and 99 months. And that's a big deal, because it means that it's some of the patients, a lucky few who has been treated with this therapy, they have a long response. And this is one of the things that I really want to emphasize in case of immunotherapy, that those patients, it is like vaccination. If you are responding, then there might be a cure for it. And again, just kind of showing how so there are different kind of protocols, combination with GP100 and interleukin-2, and some of the responses are higher, but it is in the range of 8 to 25%. And this is basically the same thing. And how does this effect compare to the BRAF inhibitors? Well, in BRAF inhibitors, what we see is basically that as they got the BRAF inhibitor, there will be patients who will eventually die by their disease. So the BRAF inhibitors cannot really produce a durable response. As you can see, this is like, you know, butterfly going through the oceans. These unfortunate patients are surviving, and then one after the other is going to die. So it is not like, and the month here is like 21 months, you know, for the luckiest person. In case of immunotherapy, you know, these patients are going to 99 months, and some of them are totally cured. And the adverse events associated to BRAF is also a little bit higher. Okay, let's talk about anti-PD-1 therapies. And anti-PD-1, the big problem is that some of the patients who were not really a candidate for immunotherapy are because that there was an immunological surface or the immunogenicity of the tumor wasn't good enough for the immune system to be able to mount a response. However, this could be that the tumor is putting something on its surface, and that's why it is eluding the immune system. And this molecule, we think, could be, you know, the PD-1 molecule, which is you see here in this tumor. So even though there is a tumor which releases antigens, and then the antigen presenter cell is going to activate through T cell receptors and costimulatory signals and produce activated tumor-specific T cells, when these T cells go to the tumor environment, if it has the receptor, I mean, if it has the PD-1 molecule, then it can downregulate this response, and that's why it can preserve its ability to grow in the body and give metastasis. So this is a New England Journal of article about the safety, activity, and immune correlates of anti-PD-1 antibody treatment. And as you can see here, that there is dramatic reduction of this subcutaneous nodule in a matter of a couple of months. And if you are looking at the dosages, it was they tried the efficacy, I'm actually the safety. So they start an escalating dose from 0.1 milligram per kilogram to 10 milligram per kilogram, and they found good responses in the rearm of 4 to 46, 50%, in the 0.33 milligram per kilogram dosages. And then the disease, how stable the disease or not, you know, the patient had stable disease, you know, 11%, but then progression-free survival occurred in almost, you know, half of the patients. So if you are talking about, you know, anti-CTLA-4 therapy, and then we add this therapy, then this is probably the anti-PD-1 therapy is a more efficacious therapy. And if you are talking about melanoma, then it is approximately 28% of the patients showed actually objective responses. So what you need to know about is that anti-PD-1 antibody produced objective responses approximately 1 in 4 to 1 in 5 patients with non-small cell lung cancer, melanoma, and renal cancer. And the adverse event profile does not appear to preclude its use, which is fantastic. And the preliminary data suggests a relationship between PD-L1 expression on tumor cells and objective response. So it means, you know, that if the tumor is actually expressing the PD-1, PD-L1 molecule, then has a better cure rate. But as I will show you later, even patients who have PD-1L negative tumors, they are also showing responses. So, and this is another patient who presented with a nodule. And this is actually came to us, and it was a 36-year-old lady, and it was a very, very bad thing to say to the doctor and then to her that she has metastatic melanoma. And the only thing that we can do as a pathologist to do our stains, and we do the PD-L1 staining, and if it is positive, as in this case, and usually it is a very weak staining, it gives a little bit of hope to these patients that he or she will respond. And then finally, I'm going to talk about adoptive T cell therapy in the last couple of slides. And what is adoptive immunotherapy? When I was at the NIH, we did this. So basically, this is a lymph node involved by tumor cells. And you can see here is a tumor, here is the lymph node parenchyma. And then we took out part of this tumor. And as you can see, the blue cells are the tumor cells. The brown cells are the CD8 positive T cells. And then this tumor was minced, and then the tumor infiltrated lymphocytes were put into cultures that they add interleukin 2. And then, as you can see here, these cells were infused to the patient. And the question was, you know, whether immunotherapy was effective. Immunotherapy only resulted like 2.6% response in patients, so it wasn't too effective. However, a small percentage of patients who, this is actually not, you know, the adoptive T-cell therapy, this is more of interleukin-2 therapy. Those patients who receive interleukin-2 therapy, a very small percentage of the patient had a long survival for, you know, for 132 months after the therapy. So what could be the reason for this prolonged survivors? The reason is actually these cell types, the FOXP3 positive T regulatory cells. And these T regulatory cells my presentation quit. Okay, so this is the next slide. So this FOXP3 positive cells, and then let's see the next one. So, and why is that? Because these cells are radio sensitive. I really want to show you that, you know, it is a paper from 1982. So what is happened that there is a thyroid gland, as you can see, this is a rat, and then the rat was thymectomized and radiated, and that actually induced an autoimmune thyroiditis. So here there is the thyroid gland, and this is the thyroiditis. And this is an even earlier report from the same group that spontaneous thyroiditis is actually happening in thymectomized and irradiated Vista rats. And if we add radiation treatment, then we can actually boost the immune response. So, and this is how it was done at the bench, because this is data on rats, and I'm going to show you, actually not rats, but mice. So what happened here that these mice got tumor transplanted into them, and then they were looking at that how this tumor actually grew. So those patients who got irradiation but didn't get the cell treatment, their tumor will grow without problem. And compared to those rats that had a high dosage of radiation and also get these cells infused back to them, actually are able to suppress the tumor growth. And that is basically a basis for this adoptive T-cell therapy. And as you can see, that is depending on how much radiation you apply to these mice, their fur will change as they will actually acquire a vitiligenous phenotype. So this mice is the same black mice as this one, but because there will be lymphocytes that are attacking those melanocytes, they are acquiring this gray or white phenotype. So what they did, and they did the lymphodepletion by two ways. One was the irradiation, the other one was that they applied cytotoxic drugs. They were able to eliminate those cells, as I show you here, that there are lots of cells which are not CD8 positive T cells. So with irradiation and with chemotherapy, they were able to eliminate those cells, and only the effector cells, the CD8 positive T cells, were present, which were able to go and attack the tumor. And this is how the protocol was set up. So the patient got cyclophosphamide and fludarabine, and then got radiation, and after all this preconditioning regimen, they gave the TIL therapy and the interleukin 2 infusion. And this patient had absolutely remarkable responses. As you can see, this is like multiple disseminated metastases affecting the liver. And 1 month after the treatment, these lesions totally disappeared. Same lesion in the chest area. There are a couple of subcutaneous nodules all over. And as you can see here, after 1 month, there is a significant reduction. And these T cells actually go also going through the blood-brain barrier. As you can see, there are two brain mets here, which disappeared after 1 month. And what has happened here, that there is a chemotherapy, irradiation, total body irradiation, they were able to achieve 52% 52% rate of complete response or objective response by RECIST criteria with two complete responses. So, you know, that's an absolutely great result. And in this case, they are describing a lot of patients, and the conclusions are that cell transfer therapy with autologous TILs can mediate durable complete responses in patients with metastatic melanoma, and that's similar irrespective if these patients were treated previously or not. And again, 5% survival I put here, you know, from the HACC paper, it is 5% for this patient. And some of them, as I will show you, are actually going to have even larger survival rate. So what really makes significance here, the telomere lengths of the infused lymphocytes, the longer the telomere lengths, the better the response. The amount of the CD8 positive T cells that are infused and the persistence of these cells beyond 1 month are the important factors, what is basically responsible for a better overall survival. And here, if the patient got irradiation, only 200 or 1200 TBI irradiation, there are partial responses and there are complete responses. And the overall response here, as you can see, 49%, 52%, as I was telling you before with that article. And then, you know, the largest response were like 72% with this 1200 TBI protocol. So our patient that I showed to you actually went to the NIH and got this treatment. And he showed also these lesions, which is, as you are dermatologists, who would offer a diagnosis here? What could this be? This is a patient who goes through immunotherapy, got a bunch of drugs. This is like a small stem cell transplant and evolved this rash. And this is like GVHD type of thing. Very good, very good. So basically, this is a type of like a GVHD. The differential would be reaction to drug, infectious viral bacteria, or this could be an immunotherapy associated dermatitis. So basically what is happening here, I mean, those arrows are for a reason, because those areas were vitiligenous before, and the clinician knew that the patient had actually here melanoma excised from this area. And with that, you know, the response is not occurring at those areas. So it is kind of confirming that this is a specific response against melanocytes. So what it would be if it is a reaction to drug, then we would have a CD3 and a CD4 positive reaction pattern with a minuscule amount of CD8 positive cells. So this is not the pattern for it. And this is a melanase staining, or MART1 staining shows the preserved melanocytes in the case of a viral or just an eczematous process. In case of a tumor-infiltrating lymphocyte-associated dermatitis, we have a different thing. So there are different histological patterns. It could be like this MF-like pattern. It could be also like this spongiotic pattern. And then you have you know, if you're doing the MART1 staining, then you have specific response. These are CD8 positive T cells, and this is a melanocyte that is attacked, and it is actually surrounded by these lymphocytes and leading to a satellitosis around the melanocyte. With that, I'm kind of getting concluding and talk a little bit about future trends. So the greatest obstacle is to identify targets that are specific for tumor and not expressed in normal tissues. And why is that important? Because, you know, if it also acts on normal tissues, then there will be a lot of therapy-associated side effects. And then the possible targets could be immunogenic mutations expressed in individual cancers, and that could be an ideal tumor target. And this is a paper written by the Rosenberg group in Science. And what they found, that there was a patient with a GI tract, I think it was a colon duct cancer. It was a metastatic cholangiocarcinoma. And this tumor overexpressed the ERBB2 gene. And they also found that the patient had T helper cells that were sensitive to this. So they took these cells and were able to grow them up outside of the body. And then they reinfused the patient, and they were able to achieve tumor regression and a durable response. So this is really kind of futuristic here, but it is happening. So at the NIH, a patient comes in, they take the tumor out, they do a whole exomic sequencing of the tumor, they identify a target, and then they are able to produce a personalized cancer treatment. Okay, and another future trend, which is if you are in Miami, we say, you know, it is white hot. This is the combination therapies with the BRAF and kinase inhibitors, but really the white hot treatment here is a combination of anti-CTLA-4 and anti-PD-1 therapies, and maybe even combining this with adoptive immunotherapy. And this is a very recent article from the New England Journal of Medicine, which talks about nivolumab and ipilimumab combination therapy. And it tells us that these patients were previously untreated with metastatic melanoma, and they found that the combination of these two agents are actually able to achieve a better response than one alone. And this is the data, as you can see, that it is the if they apply both agents, then there are like partial responses are happening 40% of the cases, there are stable disease 13%, complete response in 11%. So this is a very, very promising thing. Our patient, that one that I showed to you, went through adoptive immunotherapy, and now he's actually getting nivolumab. So the conclusions are about this talk. And the first part of the talk, I was mentioning genetic and immunological knowledge, transforming our view and patient-related approaches of nevi and melanoma. And melanoma immunotherapies offer durable, complete responses. And it is extremely important to emphasize cure for selected patients. And these selected patients are actually an even growing population of patients. So patients with melanoma should look up, you know, some of these research protocols, because they actually may find a cure. And let me see if I can go. So in my mind, you know, my answer to Ivan Reitman is that actually there is a plenty of magic in medicine, because when I see these results, I'm absolutely get enthusiastic about, you know, modern medicine and how much we were able to achieve in the last couple of decades, and all this progression is actually increasing as we are talking. And with all that, I would like to thank you for your attention. And I would like to acknowledge two persons especially. One of them, Dr. Boris Bastian, who contributed enormously to the genetic understanding of melanoma, nevi, and spitzoid lesions. And on the immunotherapy, Dr. Steven A. Rosenberg, who has been working on immunotherapy for several decades, and a lot of patients thank him for his persistence. I'm really happy to see his breakthrough achievements. So with all that, I would like to also acknowledge some people, Dr. Turner, that I got some of the pictures from the NIH. Your help me with the second case. Dr. Mini, I got images from the third case, Dr. Platzer from the second case, and Carlos also. And if you guys have questions, please let us know. And I'm happy to take any questions if you have.